Ed Schultz News and Commentary is brought to you by BioGreen Clean, the iSave Team, RingOfFireRadio.com, the Communication Workers of America, and the Alliance for American Manufacturing.
Good to have you with us on Ed Schultz News and Commentary this morning. Well, we have seen, witnessed, and now we're living the transition of Hillary Clinton when it comes to climate change. The Keystone XL pipeline apparently is not a good thing. After all these months, after having the experience of being Secretary of State and watching this legal debate go back and forth, Hillary Clinton has finally decided that Keystone's not a good thing because of climate change. She says Keystone is the Obama administration's decision, and she wants to wait and see what they do before weighing in. This is what she said back in July.
This is President Obama's decision, and I am not going to second guess him. So I want to wait and see what he and Secretary Kerry decide. If it's undecided when I become president, I will answer your question.
Well, she left out one name, and that was Bernie Sanders, because when he jumped in the race, he has been very crystal clear about where he has been on the Keystone XL pipeline, which of course would line the pockets of the Koch brothers. Last week, Clinton put the administration on notice, saying that she was about ready to do a decision and a reversal. Here it is.
I have been waiting for the administration to make a decision. I thought I owed them that. I can't wait too much longer, and I am putting the White House on notice. I'm going to tell you what I think soon, because I can't wait. I thought they would have it decided way by now, and they haven't.
She can't wait because her base is eroding. Those who are concerned about climate change in this election cycle want a candidate that's going to recognize it and do something about it. So finally, in of all places, Des Moines, Iowa, where she has to win, on Tuesday, Hillary Clinton finally says, you know, Keystone's not good.
I feel now I've got a responsibility to you and other voters who ask me about this. And I think it is imperative that we look at the Keystone Pipeline as what I believe it is, a distraction from the important work we have to do to combat climate change. And unfortunately, from my perspective, one that interferes with our ability to move forward to deal with all the other issues. Therefore, I oppose it.
Well, she's opposed it. But the fact is, she didn't mention it's going to go over the aquifer, which is a risk. It's going to put money in the Koch brothers' pockets, and it's also the dirtiest oil to be produced in the world. Just some key points there. Let's go to Jane Kleeb, director of Bold Nebraska, which is a citizens advocacy group. She's been fighting this since 2010. Jane, good to have you with us today.
Thanks, Ed.
What do you make of this reversal, and how important is it, and what kind of impact does it have?
Yeah, I mean, it is a huge reversal, and we've been waiting for 7 years for Secretary Clinton to come on the side of farmers and ranchers and environmentalists to say that she opposes this risky pipeline. And I think it's going to have implications for the Democratic race. I think there have been progressives sitting on the sidelines waiting for her to make a decision on Keystone. Obviously, Bernie Sanders continues to be the key leader in the Democratic field on this issue. But, you know, I also think that this definitely, you know, you can look at it in lots of ways, but on the outset, it boxes the president in. You know, there's no way out now for him to kind of essentially try to approve the pipeline. We've always thought he was going to, you know, reject it anyway. But now this seems to solidify that path.
How much did Bernie Sanders play into Hillary Clinton's decision? How much of this is political, and how genuine do you think it is?
If it wasn't for Bernie Sanders in the race, quite frankly, I think she would have stayed silent. Now, there were lots of young activists on the campaign trail, both in Iowa as well as New Hampshire in particular, constantly going to her events, doing really creative things like writing on their hands because the Clinton people wouldn't let them bring signs in and interrupting her speeches. And so she was definitely feeling the heat on the campaign trail, but she was mostly feeling the heat in the polls and Bernie Sanders taking a lot of progressive base voters away from her. So, I mean, he deserves a tremendous amount of praise for really pushing Clinton to do the right thing here.
Do you think people who are concerned about the environment and climate change as being a big issue are going to accept this reversal by Clinton?
I think that the really loyal folks who know all the ins and outs about Keystone XL and know the fight along the route as well as up in the tar sands region in Alberta I don't think they'll accept it. I think that they will hang on the word that she used, saying that it was a distraction. I think, you know, obviously for me in the heartland, I'm disappointed that she didn't talk about water and property rights and tribal concerns along the route. So I think that there's going to be some concern there. And I think she needs to stop being just dismissive that, you know, climate change is this real issue. It's not just for a niche few elite. And so I think she did miss an opportunity. And I think if she really, you know, tries to take this issue the right way, I think she will start attacking Republicans on eminent domain. Carly Fiorina and all of them are talking about eminent domain now and complaining about how Trump used eminent domain. She should go right at them with eminent domain on Keystone.
Interesting point. No question about it. All right. Now, Jane, what about the legal aspect? I understand there were like multiple days of hearings in South Dakota for the permitting. Where are we on that?
So the permit in South Dakota is still expired. The South Dakota Public Utilities Commission has not granted TransCanada a new construction permit. We still don't know when that may happen or if they're going to reject it or add new construction conditions to it. The landowners in Nebraska go to court on October 19th for their hearing on challenging eminent domain as well as the legal route that the governor used to give them a permit. That's also the date of when Canada has their elections on the prime minister. And it looks like Harper, who, as you know, has spent tens of millions of dollars of government money pushing Keystone, is going to lose his election. So there's big shifts happening right now on the Keystone fight at all fronts.
Jane Kleeb, Bold Nebraska director. Great to have you with us, Jane. Keep up the fight. You are definitely with the wind at your back on this one. Great work. Thank you.
Thanks, Ed. It's all because of you, too. Thanks, man.
Now this.
Hey, folks, you've heard me talk about BioGreen Clean. I'm going to show you right now on my airplane just how tough this is. I want you to keep in mind, chemical-free, 100% plant-derived, biodegradable. It is the safest cleaner that you can get, and it's the most effective. Go to our website, wegoted.com, or go to biogreenclean.com. www.biogreenclean and order today.
So to wrap up the Keystone issue, I don't think there's any doubt that Hillary Clinton would not be where she is today on this had it not been for Bernie Sanders pushing the issue. And it's important, and I accept Hillary Clinton's change if she holds to it, and that's a big if. Bernie Sanders is also making people in this country realize the moral obligation, and he's connecting it to faith. The timing of the Pope's visit is more than interesting in this presidential race. The bottom line is, it's about morality. And what the Republicans have done in Congress is immoral in the eyes of many Americans, the way they want to attack everything on the social safety net. And when it comes to climate change, the Pope has a much different view from the Republicans, and Sanders is quick to point that out.
And he is also, by the way, talking very profoundly and significantly about climate change. And he's talking about it as a religious person. This is God's earth. You cannot destroy it. And we have to be aggressive in transforming our energy system.
One of the most refreshing things about Bernie Sanders, he speaks the truth and is so profound. And very seldom does he comment on other candidates or situations, but this time he did. He gave an observation about Donald Trump and how life seems to be going with the Republicans.
I don't think it's presidential, and I don't think it's presidential to be attacking all of your opponents and being very nasty and petty. You know, I don't think we want a president who is just bad-mouthing everybody. It seems like there's almost nobody in the world that this guy doesn't dislike. So, no, I don't think that's what a president should be.
And the one thing I like about Trump is the fact that he says he will not seek any endorsement from Scott Walker. Actually, that's going to gain him more support. This is Ed Schultz News and Commentary. We've got interviews on our website with Mark Dimondstein, the American Postal Workers Union president, who was talking about what is happening in Congress that no one's paying attention to when it comes to the Postal Service. And also, we've got more interviews to check out at WeGotEd.com, RawStory.com, and RingOfFireRadio.com. This is Ed Schultz News and Commentary, brought to you by Communication Workers of America, Alliance for American Manufacturing, BioGreen Clean, and the iSave team.
It's time to continue our conversation about mechanical insulation. Mechanical insulation is for the piping systems in our nation's commercial and industrial facilities. Facility owners are burning up billions of dollars through the lack of mechanical insulation on these piping systems. Call the iSave team. Insulation saves America valuable energy, and this team of energy conservation specialists is shovel-ready to save you money. Visit iSaveTeam.org to have a specialist give your plant an energy audit.
We perpetuate a culture of crime all the way from Wall Street right down to the Main Street in our hometowns.
It's worse than it has been since FDR took control of the problem and said we can't count on industry taking care of the American labor.
They probably have already engaged in some type of criminal cover-up.
And the law prohibits the government from even doing anything about it.
Catch America's lawyer Mike Papantonio on YouTube at youtube.com/goleftTV.
You're listening to Ed Schultz News and Commentary from Fighting Bob Fest in Madison, Wisconsin. And now Ed is joined by American Postal Workers Union President Mark Dimondstein.
Mark Dimondstein with us. He is the president of American Postal Workers Union. It's an ongoing story about the way you have had to deal with this pre-funded health care and retirement benefit. That fund is huge right now. Where's that money? Is it going to your workers? What's happening?
No, it's we consider it a theft of postal revenues, which is created by the users, not the taxpayer, into the federal treasury. We don't know what they're doing it there. And it's a $50 billion fund right now. We're better for the post office. It's better funded on future retiree health costs than any agency, any company. But it's being used to just choke the post office, manufacture this crisis, then say the post office is in trouble. We got to privatize it. We got to degrade it. We got to slow down service. We got to close post offices. And the very same congressional people that voted this through in 2006 have not fixed it.
Well,
and can and should.
And so the lie here is that there's no guarantee that that money is going to go to your workers. That's one of the travesties.
We don't know what the federal. It's just like
it's in the treasury.
Else. It's in the treasury. It's in the treasury.
It's a rob
somewhere. It's a rob. It's a theft. Somebody asked me the other day, is it a loan? I said, no, it's not a loan. It's a looting of the postal revenues. Postal revenues are there to make the post office go. That's what they're there for. Buy new trucks. Open new facilities. Keep places open later. Enhance and expand services. That's what the money's for. It's supposed to be a break-even basis. And, of course, pay workers well, because living wages are good for all of us, all of our neighborhoods, all of our towns. And look to the future. And when it's drained like that, it's very difficult for this thing to be the kind of vibrant post office that it needs to be, can be, and should be.
We're a little over a year out. How crucial is this election? You need an ally in the White House.
Well, certainly we would like to have an ally in the White House. We need one in the White House, and we need a better ally than we have in the White House now, to be perfectly blunt about it.
Yeah. Yeah, this has not changed at all.
No.
They haven't done anything about it.
No.
They've allowed it to happen.
They've allowed it to happen, and we haven't gotten the kind of support out of the White House that there should be. When I say we, I'm talking about the people of the country for the kind of postal service they should have.
So the drive to privatize is still there by a number of lawmakers.
Absolutely. But it's happening by hook or by crook. It's not, you know, we don't expect it to be one legislative act, but just by hook or by crook, like the Staples deal with the post office is a privatization thrust of retail services.
Yeah.
All these pre-sort corporate, we call it corporate welfare discounts to the mailers. Most of the public doesn't even know about this. We pay 49 cents. They may pay, a big mailer may pay 35 cents. And that's that's also draining funds from the postal service. So, you know, these are some of the things going on out there.
But the public is waking up to this?
We hope so. We can't win this without the public. This post office doesn't belong to the American Postal Workers Union. Certainly doesn't belong to the postal managers. Doesn't belong to Congress. It belongs to the people of the country.
Yeah.
It's theirs. And it's the most trusted federal agency year after year after year, even with the problems created with the mail. And so the people of the country are going to have to stand together. We're standing with them. We hope they stand with us to make sure that we have a vibrant public postal service for generations to come. It can be, it needs to be. In the day of e-commerce, is probably more important than ever.
Yeah. Mark, there's a candidate out there that very clearly has been in your corner. Bernie Sanders. Yet he has not picked up a lot of endorsements of labor, and labor's kind of keeping their powder dry. Do you have any thoughts on that? And what kind of impact has Sanders had with his advocacy with the postal workers and just to save the system that we have and enhance it?
Right. Well, listen, our union has yet to endorse because we have a process.
Yeah.
And we're going through that now. But having said that, there's no question that Senator Sanders, more than any other candidate running, has been a champion of postal workers and raising broad workers' issues that need to be raised, like $15 an hour for all workers. And he's not just the champion of postal workers during election time. He's been a champion of postal workers long before he ever thought about running for president. He's been there in the streets with us to keep these post offices open.
Yeah.
He's worked in Congress to try to get positive postal reform to deal with this pre-funding crisis and other things. So he's a serious candidate. He's certainly hitting and creating tons of excitement. People in the country are disgusted, rightfully so, and I think Senator Sanders is right. People are saying enough is enough of the billionaires ruling, and that includes the billionaires ruling when it comes to the post office. So I know, and I would expect that Bernie Sanders is going to have more labor support as time goes on.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be talking about it in our union shortly. We have some executive board meetings and some big meetings with the workers. I've simply asked, as the president of my union, for people to give me their opinion. And the opinions that are coming back are running pretty strongly that Bernie Sanders has been there for us. We need to be there with Bernie Sanders, but more importantly, we need to work together to build a movement to save this national treasure.
Are your workers motivated? Are your union members motivated to do the social networking and the boots on the ground that's going to be needed? For instance, in Ohio. I mean, that is going to be such a pivotal place in this next election. What about that?
I think, look, it's always a challenge to motivate. But I think it depends who the candidates are.
Yeah.
I think if it's Tweedledum, Tweedledee, people are going to stay home and not be that motivated. I think if there are candidates like Bernie Sanders that people trust, they trust what they're saying, they know it's just not election time promises, the program and the platform is very concrete, and they've been a champion out there fighting for us, I think you're going to see a lot of motivation and a lot of excitement in the campaign. So we'll have to see what happens. I can tell you our members are like a lot of union members. They are pretty tired of the Tweedledum, Tweedledee, lesser of two evil politics.
Yeah.
If we remain in that, a lot of people are going to sit this out like they sit out a lot of elections. So we definitely encourage our people to be politically involved. We think it's vital. But the reality is that a lot of times there's not much difference between the political parties, and our members aren't stupid.
Great. Thanks, Mark. Appreciate it. I appreciate you offering that up. Thank you. Mark, keep up the fight.
Ed, very good seeing you.
Thanks so much. Good to see you here.
Appreciate everything you've done. Same here.
Thanks.
From the steel mills of Pennsylvania to the auto factories of Michigan to the modern makers movement, manufacturing makes our nation great. I'm Scott Paul, president of the Alliance for American Manufacturing. We bring business and labor together to advocate for policies that everyone can agree on. Together, we can strengthen manufacturing and create good-paying American jobs. Help us keep it made in America.
Listening to Ed Schultz News and Commentary from Fighting Bob Fest in Madison, Wisconsin. And now, Ed is joined by Lizz Winstead, creator of The Daily Show.
sir.
The wonderful, the lovely, the talented, the funny, the everything, Lizz Winstead.
And Schultz, hi.
I know you miss me.
I do miss you terribly.
I miss you too.
I know, you know, it's so, it's kind of, it's really awesome to be here with you at Bob Fest. And, you know, I learned about Bob Fest, and, well, Bob, from Wellstone's book. And so it makes, I don't know, this whole symbiotic you and me in Minnesota, and we're in Wisconsin and we're Packer fans and Minnesota would hate it. It's all really good.
Okay. I'm hearing you're getting 10,000 people when you go around the country advocating for women to keep their body parts.
Yes.
What's happening?
Well,
that is amazing, by the way.
It is kind of incredible to have a little organization called Lady Parts Justice where we have brought a bunch of cultural musicians, comedians, Sarah Silverman, Amy Schumer, you know, John Fugelsang, all these people together to talk about this issue in pop culture spaces. And it's really fun to go to big music festivals like Bumbershoot and do three shows and have a booth and have young people flock to you. And the fascinating thing about it was when I said, you know, I'm sort of stunned because I didn't realize what we were hitting. And I said, what is it about us that made you come here? And they said, well, we were visiting traditional feminist spaces and nobody stopped to ask us where we were at with this issue. And you guys have young people working for you. You actually ask questions about how we feel about it, how we want to go about change. And so we're here, and it was pretty awesome.
Well, the latest story here in Wisconsin, as I understand, they just had a House committee meeting where all these guys were together, and they're deciding these bills on birth control.
You
so
know,
I thought maybe you might want to bust that meeting up next time.
You know, the guys, they love to talk about the birth control, and I don't know. The Supreme Court, sadly, has now said your boss can talk about the birth control through the Hobby Lobby case, and I'm thinking, there's a craft store that brought a case to the Supreme Court begging to have say over birth control because under religious views, right?
Yeah.
And then I'm thinking, a craft store with religious views? I don't think it's about religion. I think it's about the bottom line. Because if you're having really good sex, you're doing way less crafting. Right? You know, no one says, oh, honey, I'd like to tonight, but I've got to finish my knitting. No one has ever said that. So I think that we just need to pay attention constantly to the reasons that these people are trying to keep women and birth control in the forefront. Because if you have birth control, that means you say, I want to take some control. And the right wing has decided that sharing power means you're taking power away. And I think that is the giant difference between why we're progressives, because we want everyone to have a seat at the table so we have an equal world.
So as an advocate, as a stand-up comic, as a satirist, the material just keeps on coming, doesn't it?
The material keeps on coming. In fact, Lady Parts Justice, this is really cool. We just launched an app that I just have to say with pride was rejected by iTunes. It's an app that's like Tinder, which is the dating app that the kids use, but it's called Hinder. And you download the app from our website, and it has hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of anti-choice, you know, racist, bigoted, homophobic people on the site. And it looks just like a dating site, so it has a picture, it has stats about what they've said, it has a fact check link, and you can scroll through it, you can share it on Facebook and Twitter, and you can search by state to find out the people in your state who are the bad actors. It's really fun. Hinder. So go to Lady Parts Justice.
H-I-N-D-R?
H-I-N-D-R. Yeah.
She's pretty good, huh?
I can spell, too. I know.
Kenya.
I know.
Lady Parts.
Yes.
So is Bernie your guy?
I am on the list of artists who support Bernie. Bernie is my guy. I have come out. I'm officially endorsing Bernie.
What do you think?
I think I'm really excited to hear a debate because the one thing that I love hearing Bernie talk about is taxing Wall Street. I love hearing him talk about how those transactions should be taxed. I think it makes sense to workers. I think it makes sense to everybody in our lives. We buy things, we're taxed on them. Why shouldn't people who are trading stocks have to pay taxes on it? I don't understand.
Okay, now this is a sexist question, but we're friends, okay?
What,
Hillary, isn't this an awesome chance for women in America to have our first female president? And how do you view that?
Well,
the reason why I'm asking you that question is because
I don't hear Hillary talk about breaking up the big banks. I don't hear her talking about going after the offshore money that the corporations hide, okay? I don't hear her talking about universal health care. She wasn't talking about college for all until Bernie did.
No.
Okay.
Talk about the environment.
I don't hear anything on trade.
I'm not going to weigh in on Keystone.
Yeah.
I'm not president
okay.
now.
All right.
No,
so what about? So it's the issues.
It's the issue. You know, here's the thing. What I think is really exciting about where we're at, especially if we're talking about feminism, is that I don't feel desperate that there's not going to be a woman who's going to be president in my lifetime. And I feel really lucky that I don't have to compromise on this particular person just because she's a woman. I mean, I'll tell you what, I have been a political satirist since 1990, which means I've covered her husband's administration, her, and I've had to do jokes. It was funny, when Bill Clinton was president and people said, oh, it must have been a gold mine for you, it really wasn't, because it was just a lot of sex jokes. And I was writing jokes about NAFTA and about the Telecommunications Act and about welfare reform, and nobody even knew that was happening because that BJ stuff was happening all the time. And meanwhile, you have a woman who was in bed with corporate America for a long time. She was the Walmart attorney. You know, they've never been people. I'm a progressive person. I've been a progressive person since I'm 25. And these were not progressive people. And so to ask me to support someone because they're a woman when they don't share my values seems anathema to my values. And I'm really excited that I can support somebody who has a voting record that has been consistent, who has been somebody who has believed in things and voted on them and advocated for things that I hold dear to my heart, and I'm excited about it. You know, not since Wellstone. Like, I feel like, oh my God, kind of in that moment again.
Give me 30 seconds on Trump.
Oh my God, first of all. Okay.
Good stuff.
Donald Trump, first of all, this whole GOP landscape, it's like, I can't even, it's like trying to decide which package of expired meat would be safe enough to eat that's in your fridge. Like, I don't even know how to do it. But basically, Donald Trump has replaced bed bugs as America's number one pest. This is what I will say about Donald Trump. I'm about to go say it on stage.
And Carly Fiorina.
Carly Fiorina is interesting because, you know, when Carly Fiorina, she's sort of like an off-brand Margaret Thatcher. You know, she's like the Hydrox Margaret Thatcher. And the fact that they are so excited about this warmongering woman, like, it was sort of freaking me out the next day after the debate to hear how excited all the conservatives were that she won the debate because she was just going to go in there and she could list the name of every army of every country in the Middle East and how she was going to bomb anything. I mean, she made Kissinger sound like Gandhi. I'm like, what is happening here?
Go get him, girl.
Okay.
Liz, great to see you.
Great to see you, Eddie. Be in touch. Will you be in touch?
I will.
Okay.
You bet.